Okay, thank you very much for being here for the last session of today. And the last session of today will be to talk about the place of navigation. And I called it in daily practice to make it a little bit more precise. And we know that at this moment in the US, 75% of the ENT practices have navigation. And I just asked our colleagues here what they guessed it was in Europe, and figures are around 20-25%. So that's an enormous difference, and that is a good thing to discuss here together. I send you all a few questions that I would like to discuss today. Okay, Agnieszka, may I ask you to give the first overview?
Thank you very much for the invitation to be a part of this outstanding, very important meeting. I am ENT surgeon, but today I'm representing the Medtronic, and I would like to talk about the navigation, since this company has 17 years of the history working this technology. We calculated almost 4,000 sinus accounts in Europe exist, and more than 300 of those navigating with fusion system. There are 4.3 navigated cases on average per month per account. So what is in the history in the technology? What happens when the technology was developed? Technology develop, new solutions appear. One of the key things is the in-house development of electromagnetic tracking system with accuracy equivalent to the optical. Medtronic pioneered simpler and more intuitive workflow based on around surgeon preference profile. Another important thing is the patient tracking with the single stick on device and surface contour registration refinements. And also today, the surgeon can use in combination with navigation different complementary tools like microdebriders, balloons, or malleable suction. So this is what we have and what comes in the future. The technological advancement should improve the benefits of IGS, and it can be defined as a meaningful reduction in complication rate and surgeon's workflow. What does it mean? How we can achieve it? It could be smarter communication between IGS and hospital network and ancillary devices. It would be perhaps interesting to have a wireless EM devices. It could be achieved through more robust preoperative planning that can be viewed in a traditional navigation view or 3D virtual endoscopic view or augmented reality or combination of those. Another important thing is registration improvement. It can be less subjective, brings more feedback on based on the quality and accuracy, and also to bring the intraoperative refinement. These tools could be used, could be available outside of the OR through planning station, cloud, or cloud-based software. And the more futuristic today could be integrated with surgical robots. So where we are today with the clinical application of navigation, we have currently three guidelines. One comes from the American Academy, one comes from the Australia, and the recently published this year International Consensus Statement. All these guidelines focus on the most difficult cases that the surgeon expects some higher risk of the complications. The surgeries performed in the tertiary reference centers. But this is what we have today. As our thinking evolves, we could take into consideration future. And it can be divided into three groups. One could be summarized as a complexity. Increase of level of complexity of surgical procedures that is accompanied by more extended use of IGS. And the lateral scalp-based surgery is such an example. Or it could be defined as a simplicity when we think about balloon technology or extended and safe surgical application in so-called out of the operating room setting. And the last is when we think about planning. Planning the surgery, all kinds of activity can be performed prior to the surgery and can be used in the office setting, in the discussion with the patient. So if we conclude, what we could say is some take-home messages. The familiarity with the IGS system has to be achieved for the best performance and the best patient results. Proficient usage requires proper and regular practice. There is study confirming that being unfamiliar with the usage of IGS can lead to more stress than real help when using the system in the case where it is truly needed. And the technology advancement of IGS could support more complex procedures, but also more complete dissections, both in OR as in office. And last but not least, IGS is a very useful surgical and teaching tool, but it is important to view the system as a support and validation of your decision making, not a replacement for it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Fiagon started out as a company only focusing on image guidance, so navigation. We started with a system for ENT in 2009, went into the market 2010, and we focused on ease of use. So what we experienced as well is technologies coming from brain surgery in the early days, the utilization in the ENT surgery was not optimized. So we created a system, small footprint, integratable, using electromagnetic technology. I'm CTO, but not for the nice technology, but for advanced ease of use. So the sensor that we use are very tiny, can be integrated in the tip of the instruments, by this achieving a high accuracy of the of this navigation approach, very much comparable to the optical systems, with the advantage of having malleable instruments by having the measuring point directly in the tip. The system itself should step in the background, so we designed it like being part of the normal OR inventory, so placed in the endoscopic stack. The navigation field generator is integrated in the headrest, so it's no technical object anymore, it's part of the daily routine. And it's always in the OR, so this was the approach to get it into the clinical routine. By having miniaturized the sensors, being able to produce adapters like a guide wire that you can introduce into cannulated instruments. So the spectrum of our instruments has increased throughout the years. So we provide suction tubes, curettes, all having the same feature being navigated at the tip, which is profitable for the accuracy, but also for having new possibilities by bending the tools and reaching cavities that you cannot reach with stiff instruments. Also to the ease of use, also to accuracy, but accuracy is not really a point to discuss anymore. It has to be delivered by us companies that provide image guided surgery to a certain level, but the ease of use, so one part of it is the registration procedure. So we developed in the latest version a registration method that is touchless, utilizing an iPad. So the iPad is our interface to the system, to steer the system, to load the DICOM data, but also to perform the registration. So this is done by just taking three pictures of the patient, being placed on the OR table. The patient is prepared, having the localizer attached already with a double-sided tape to the forehead, and then you shoot those three pictures. Those are transferred to the system and the registration is calculated. So this has two effects, that we get a high amount of points that is needed for this registration without actually, well, by the photo itself. So you don't have to have the knowledge of which points are necessary to achieve good accuracy. And it is a really easy approach to do it. So with this technology and also with this strategy, also this goes also throughout the software, we were able to establish more and more sites in Europe, in USA, and to get navigation ready basically in the OR for every surgery. Of course, we will discuss that later, that it's not used for every surgery, but it's available for every surgery. And this is, for us, one step into the daily routine of using navigation as, and I want to say this clearly, for us, this is a additional information, the need of it, we will discuss later on here, additional information that might help in several occasions throughout the surgery. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Thank you very much, both of you. I would like to start with my first question. We have seen these advisors from the American Academy, from the Australian Academy of where to use navigation. In Europe, until now, we decided not to do that. And I think this is a good forum to ask, do we need navigation in every case? Does every surgeon need navigation? And if yes, in which cases? And if no, in which cases? So, Manuel, maybe I can start with you and then go around to ask your opinion.
Thanks, Victor. I would say that basically for normal FES cases, and that means primary surgery, there is no need to use the navigation system. There may be some exceptions. When you have a very difficult anatomy, the anatomy has been distorted by prior trauma. In revision cases where you feel that the frontal is very difficult to be assessed and you do not exactly know, and you want to prevent an external trephination, that would be a very good indication. And that is from the anatomic perspective. The other advantage I would see in normal cases is that my impression is that the residents have a steeper learning curve, so that they have the confirmation of where they are through the system, and then the learning is faster. That is the advantage. What I do not see, and I can say that clearly, is there is no advantage concerning the complication rate doing surgery with or without. That has not been proven, not neither here nor in the States or elsewhere. But I think it's a useful tool. It is good to have it there. The problem is, if you're not using it regularly, what happens when you want to use it then? So I leave that question open.
I want to ask Sanna. We all work in referral clinics. We all see patients who have had four ethmoidectomies, and then you make the CT scan and, well, at least part of the ethmoid is still there. So would that be an argument for navigation to be much more consistently used in secondary care? Do you think that would help, or is it not relevant?
Yes, I think that would definitely help, especially in when you are learning to do rhinal surgery. Yes.
Metin, let me know.
I want to say a few things. First, the complication rate is not less in basic vest surgery. They have also a lot of complications. Mm-hmm. But the second point is navigation system does prevent this complication rate? I mean, did decrease the complication rate? No. And sometimes navigation systems cause more advanced complications.
So, yeah, so we don't use navigation to prevent complications. I think we all agree on that.
But
surgery can be more extensive.
If you go to court, you will be asked whether you are using navigation or not if you have a complication. For legal issues, we should use navigation. And if you are used to use navigation, you can use it. If you use it once a year, you cannot use navigation system. You should be used to using navigation system. For this reason, I teach all my residents to learn and to operate with navigation systems. And it's getting more and more popular in our country too.
Claire.
I think there's a danger if we use navigation in every case. You know, we're all of a generation where we didn't have the luxury of navigation. We had to learn the anatomy. We had to learn to interpret the scans. We had to use anatomical landmarks to confirm where we were. And it's a luxury to have the navigation to reconfirm that. And that's how we all would use it. We would work out where we were and check that. I see in the residents that have come from units where navigation is used routinely, they haven't developed that skill to the same extent. And they rely on the navigation. They follow the navigator and not their anatomical knowledge. And we've all seen pictures of lorries that have driven down narrow alleyways because their sat-nav has told them to go there, even though their inner instinct takes over. And I think there is a danger if we use it in every case that we will go down that route. I use it in the majority of my complex cases, but I make sure that my residents are comfortable doing routine FESS without it to get that balance.
Okay. Andreas.
I agree with Claire. However, when you have this system in your OR, you should definitely use it as often as possible because you have to have or you have to pass a learning curve. And if you're not used to the system, even in the more difficult case, can be a question of how to handle it properly, and then you can run in a problem. And one more comment to Metin. There is a paper published by Ramakrishnan, it's last year, and he showed that navigation is not reducing complication rates. And he said it's not, in this paper, the conclusion was navigation is not really necessary to in every case, so it depends on the case. And there's another paper by Tolisano this year published about the medical malpractice. And it seems to be that FESS is the most litigated procedure in rhinology. So I think we have to think about navigation because it provides more detailed information and you can do more meticulous dissection and so on, perhaps as well make a safer procedure. However, the publication does not show it's reducing complications, but maybe it gives you, you know, a feedback and you're more on the safe way.
But do you think, because I didn't get that answer, that the surgery would be more properly done if everybody would use navigation? Would it help surgeons to... you never know. It's always difficult. If the patient is referred, that's usually because they didn't do well. So the patients who are doing fine, we will never see. But do you think more tailored, or which could be more extensive surgery, would be better or easier with navigation? Not in your own clinic, but more in secondary care?
We all see patients who have had multiple procedures where we would consider the surgery to be incomplete. But I'm not sure that the surgeons who undertake that surgery wrongly believe that they have cleared all the ethmoids. So I'm not sure that if they had navigation in their hands, they would have done more anyway. There is a conservative philosophy. And as you say, we don't know yet whether more extensive surgery is better. So I don't think it's perhaps a lack of understanding that they have left ethmoid cells behind necessarily that would lead to some of those approaches in some cases. Perhaps not all.
But when we are honest, I mean, sometimes it's getting difficult due to bleeding to know what's behind this bony structure. And I think navigation can give you more information. And perhaps you have inflammation behind this structure and you open the cell and then it's a more complete dissection, resulting in a better outcome. So I think, yes, there may be advantage by using navigation.
When we operate off the monitor, we operate two dimensions. Navigation adds the third dimension, so the depth. But here two things I should stress. One is their accuracy is not high, because if you approach the optic nerve, 5 millimeters or 0.5 millimeters is a big size, so you can damage. There are such a few things I would like to criticize navigation systems, and it should be in our mind. If you come to a point your navigation system does not comply with your operation, then which one should you prefer? Of course, you will use your mind, your anatomic information. So you should study the films before the operation. And the other thing, so first, this registration system is not very, very highly accurate. And the second, during the operation, if it moves, what you put here, the crystals, then your navigation system changes. But more importantly, if during the surgery, if you remove the tumor on the navigation system of the monitor, you see, oh, I have 1.5 centimeter to the carotid artery, for example. But it's not. Because when you remove the tumor, carotid artery comes to midline. And if you rely only on the imaging system, then you rupture the carotid artery. We had such a case. And when you look at the imaging navigation system, you are away from the carotid artery, but he's the professor too operating. Removed the tumor and the carotid artery came to the midline and they ruptured and we repaired.
Manuel.
Yeah, but that is usually the what you highlighted together with Claire, the misunderstanding of a navigational system. A navigation system is never there to make millimetric decisions.
No.
It is just to give you an overview and orientation to see I'm right, I'm wrong, or I'm deep enough or not, but I never take a millimetric decision with a navigational system.
No.
So, and that is not the intention of a navigational system. Because, as you say, the anatomy changes while you're doing surgery, even if it's an advanced, the more, because the soft tissue gets displaced, so you need Doppler instead of navigational system. But it is like also like Andrea said, it is helpful. Yes, it is helpful. There are situations where you say, damn, I should have put on the navigational system because I have osteitis with very tough bone, and you don't see the bluish color behind because the bone is very thick. And then you would know, is that the last ethmoid cell here or is that something else? So yes, there are situations you would like to have it, but not on a routine.
Yes.
Coming back to your initial question about using navigation in every case, I mean, when you do sinus surgery, you have CT scans, and usually you rely on the CT scan because that's your roadmap in your sinuses. And it's helpful to have this CT scans on the table, you know, when you do your surgery. And you could scroll through and you can go into the anatomy and correlate your CT scans with the anatomy. So this is for me a great benefit, and as often as possible, you should use it. Training effect, learning curve.
Dirk, and then Agnieszka.
I hear from this discussion that the workflow is based on before the surgery, I take navigation or not. Wouldn't it be an approach like to have navigation on demand? So, as I said, I mean, I see it as additional information, and you directly confirmed this. Okay, now I come to the situation. Now it could help me. It's not in every surgery, but everyone comes to a point, even in a surgery that before that you went. So would that be a workflow approach that you would appreciate, saying, okay, the navigation system is there, it's switched on, for instance, but I haven't directly did everything to get it started, but then get quickly when you need the information.
And I think Manuel feels the same, I wouldn't be comfortable with that at all, because the navigation during the whole procedure, because in the beginning it's always you know where you are, it's easy, and the navigation confirms what you know. And you need that to build up that security to the one point during the surgery that you say, oops, is this really the last cell or is there one behind? You don't want to start using navigation at that moment because you want all that reconfirmation the whole time that actually it's like driving your car. You know where you are and then one moment you don't know whether it's the second or the third to the right. Agnieszka and then Andreas.
I'd like to make a couple of comments. To your point, I don't think that 4 millimeters accuracy is acceptable for the navigation. That's one thing. And it's, at least for the Medtronic systems, this is not what we look for, and this is not designed to have a 4 millimeters accuracy by the definition. Second thing is that if there is any displacement of the frame depending on the system, it has to be corrected. It has nothing to do with the system. It's our responsibility as a surgeons. Another comment to what Wytske said, the navigation, when we have a navigation in the car, all of us, we have a navigation, but we hold the wheel. We decide. Navigation doesn't change the procedure. We do what we have to do. It brings reorientation of the anatomy. As I absolutely agree with you, we have to use the navigation. Once we use it from the beginning of the surgery, we can have like Medtronic, the malleable tools, the tracking blades that recollect the anatomy all the time that you build prior to the surgery. I personally do the drawings, despite of the pre-op workload on the what kind of programs we can use. And then we go with this navigation to the OR, and you have this 3D image you mentioned. And the navigation just helps you to recollect the, reorient this anatomy. And then at the end of the day, we have to make the step. Anatomy changes as we remove the tumors, as you said. That's absolutely correct. But this is just the support for the surgery. And I absolutely fully agree with Claire that as if we are responsible for the training new generation of surgeons, we must probably put more pressure on teaching them the anatomy, teaching them the fixed anatomical landmarks, not necessarily the tiny spaces. We look always when we remove tumors, the big ones like a septum, floor of the nose, orbit, etc., etc. But the navigation is going just to help us. But we cannot, at the end of the day, this is our hand, and this is our mental workload. And as we develop the solutions for the pre-op workload, having the augmented reality, whatever, it's just preparing us. So when the surgery surprises us badly, we know what to do, where we are. I don't know, that makes sense to you.
Andreas, last comment, and then we go
sometimes
to the next question.
Sometimes I use the navigation system only for one, two, or three steps during the whole procedure. There's a main difference between guided by the system or having it as feedback system. Mm-hmm. And that's, I think, the key.
Can I summarize that when you use navigation, use it often. I wouldn't say all the time, but often. Just like the navigation in your car, if you use it once a year, you probably don't know how to use it. So you should be have a regular use if you use it. Is that something we all can agree on?
Yes.
And we probably do not think that the advantage of using it in every case or in every case in secondary care is enough at the moment to advocate that. Do we agree on that?
When you feel necessary, you should use it. Otherwise,
Manuel?
I'd like to add a comment about the navigation system that usually is not mentioned, is that you can check the scan with or without MRI before surgery.
Mm-hmm.
So you can go through the sinuses in a 3D manner and check everything before you start the surgery. You can do that the day before. You can do it 10 minutes before you start surgery. And that is an advantage I like very much, because I perhaps do not need exactly to handle with instruments and to get oriented, but I like to see everything on a 3D, on the axial, sagittal, and coronal view, and that gives me a lot of information and a lot of landmarks I won't have that precisely on a normal CT scan I have somewhere hanging around in the operating theater.
Yeah.
So that is something which the navigation systems are offering.
Okay. Now I would like to know from all of you, What is the thing you hate most in of, don't give me a name of the navigation system you use, but just what is the thing you are most irritated by when you use navigation? And then the next question will be, what is the navigation system you dream of? So you can start thinking. And now I think I start with Andreas and then go that way. So okay. What is the thing you irritate you most?
That's in some cases I use my CD and it's not working because it's a DVT. There seems to be not really a general solution. Perhaps they are the wrong format on the CD. Yes, but yeah. You know.
So technical issues.
That's yeah.
Yeah, once and a month it just doesn't work and you don't understand why.
That's it.
Yeah, that sounds familiar. Claire.
Mine's the same. You know, we set up 9 out of 10 times without any problems. Mm. Every now and then, for some reason, we can't set it up. The scans aren't compatible. In the middle of the case, it goes down. And that's why I think it's so critical that we can all adapt to working without it. If it goes down in the middle of a case, you have to be able to finish it.
Metin.
The navigation system are not dynamic. During the surgery, everything changed. Yeah. And you make mistakes. So my dream is a dynamic navigation system.
First, your irritation. The dreams are later. My irritation is this. What's your irritation?
Yes, my irritation is this.
No dynamics.
It does not show the changes in the operator.
Yeah.
I would say that an ideal navigation system would be wireless.
I first want to hear your irritation. Irritation?
So the wires and the registration problems, uh-huh. And that if it can't be joined to different types of instrumentation.
Manuel. What's
I
your
have
biggest?
Two, if I may.
Yeah, you may.
Good. One is that many patients come with their CD from outside. And if I want to do navigation, they need another CT with a 1 millimeter slices when they come with 2 millimeter slices. So that is an accessory irradiation, which I hate for patients because, well, we know already. The other thing is that when we started using navigation systems, you could reuse everything you were having there on the table. Now, I understand that. The companies have implemented a lot of single-use devices. You can use once or only 10 times, and then you have to throw it away and buy new ones, and that makes the system very expensive.
I want to add one. I really don't like it that if the surgery is longer than an hour and a half, you can be almost sure that your system is off.
Yeah.
I don't know why it's not possible to have a system staying really accurate during a longer surgery. Okay, now we go, and now we start with Manuel. What is your dream? What is the things you do not have in the navigation system at the moment? Would and of course your solve my irritation. That's part one of your dream, but what else?
Yeah, I wonder whether I can have, while looking at the screen, a super position of the coronal CAT scan exactly at the slice where I am with the tip of my instrument.
Beamed on the face, you mean?
Beamed on the endoscopic view where I am. So that I have the coronal picture exactly where I am, and I can compare with the sagittal and the axial.
In your endoscopic view?
Yeah.
Ah, that would be marvelous.
Sanna. I'm giving you ideas. That's
that's where we're here for, to give you ideas. Sanna, what is your dream?
Well, I already presented, so they are vice versa. So in my dream, it would be very easy to use for anyone, and very you can repeatedly, very easily to register and start to just to use it in the operating room. And of course, small in size and easy to move and so on.
Metin, you want one that shows what you have taken away?
Three points. One is it should be dynamic, of course. Second, it should be three-dimensional. because if it is three-dimensional, it's real navigation. You see three-dimensional, it changes your surgery. It's a great event. And the third one, CT and MRI should superimpose. So when I operate, when I want, I should see the bone, and then at the same time, I should see the soft tissue. So to remove the tumor, I should find the real place to open the bone and then switch to the MRI navigation system and find the mess and remove it. So these are the future of navigation system, and it will be realized in near future, I think.
Claire.
So I'd like the ability to navigate any instrument and malleable instruments, which we're getting towards, but with minimal disposable costs. I think the more costs we add on to our surgery, the more restrictive it will be for all of us.
And can I ask you why you want to have more instruments? Because I only use suction or a pointer for the reason that I don't want my residents or neither myself to operate on the navigation. So I operate on the screen and only the suction when I say, okay, this is this, and then this is the optic nerve, put the suction or the pointer on it and say, yes, it's correct what I thought. So I personally really do not see why you would like to have a navigated shaver, for example, because I would never use that. I think it's dangerous.
I do get that completely, and I use it in that way, but I also use it to see where my residents are, and I quite like, so they're not looking at it, but I'm watching where their shaver is in relation to the scan as well, because you've lost that.
The tracking blades. I never use the blades and at the same time looking at the navigation. This is just the some benefit from the ergonomic standpoint, that you have the blade that works as a suction, as a curette, mm-hmm. etc. We know. But when you want just to check on the navigation, you stop working, shaving, and you just look at the screen. In other words, you get the extra feature of the same instrument. And then probably you would never grab the seeker or suction, or maybe from time to time, because then your blade works the same way. That's the idea.
Yeah, I understand the mm-hmm. idea, but I don't see the use. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Andreas, what's your dream?
Okay, how many wishes do I have?
Oh, you have you can have 10 minutes of wishes.
10 minutes. Okay. I think the system navigation channel should be available for almost all ENT doctors. So the costs are really a big issue. So the companies should try to provide it in a, you know, affordable way. And I think the data are very important, how you handle it. So this cloud-like handling of data would be very helpful to go in your office, perhaps in center of the city, and you're working at the border of the city, and then how can you handle the data? So you have to use it only once, you bring it in your system, and they are available, at the system in the OR already. So this would be very nice further development of the whole navigation system. And I don't have more wishes.
Oh, you're easy to please.
it cannot be realized in 10 minutes. We need more time for this.
Manuel, no, more wishes.
Now, I'd like to add a comment on what Metin said about 3D. 3D is marvelous when you see anatomical dissections. But in fact, it does give you a tunnel vision. So the death is not real in 3D. So I'm not sure whether I would like to have 3D surgery. It looks good on the screen. It looks good for those wearing the glasses and saying, wow, that looks very nice. But for endoscopic sinus surgery, it really gives a tunnel vision with a depth which is not real. And it takes your time to find the instrument at the correct level because it's somehow artificial. So that is, I wouldn't do 3D surgery that way, at least with the systems we currently have. Perhaps in the future, who knows?
That is a learning curve for this 3D surgery, but I share similar ideas. But navigation, 3D navigation is different from 3D surgery. Navigation should be 3D, not the surgery. Surgery can do, if it is 3D, it's great. It causes some headache in the beginning, but then you get used to it. But the topic is not 3D surgery. The topic is 3D navigation system. You see 3D, it's great. It's great. It's like space trek.
Can you comment on what they, on their irritations and their wishes? What is feasible? What can we, what is possible? Or what is totally impossible?
So from irritations, as a CTO might add, yeah, I'm also irritated by having data sets, still data sets in this world that appear and are not readable. But yeah, this is a daily progress, and if we have such, it will be solved immediately. But somehow they still appear and still are not readable, some of them. For the rest of the comments, I appreciate that. I might say that quite a lot is in a pipeline, somewhere new to me, or I have to think of how that can be utilized. And this gives a kind of prioritization. So yes, I see that as well. Data transfer is a big issue or a big subject for us as well. So as I said, we're working on this, having the iPad as a platform. I don't know if that is useful for carrying the data. This has other aspects, but at least having that as the interface and collecting the data from a safe connection through the hospital network that works with that already. So this has to be more integrated, but this needs cooperation with the hospital IT and so on and so forth. But yeah, we're going that way. So our step is the navigation system, and you were hesitating mentioning system, and that's exactly what we feel as well. We don't want the system anymore. It's a navigated instrument. So that's what you need. You need the instrument that you hold into the sinuses and want the information on a monitor. This is basically what should be there. And we try to organize this in a way. The data needs to be there at the right place on the right monitor. It needs to be calculated somewhere. It doesn't have to be on a platform that is standing in the OR. It just has to be there and still in without latency, of course. So this is what we're working on, and the perfect instrument also involves wireless. Yeah, we see that as well. Prioritization is the question, and also, yeah, this what can be done in short term and what takes longer time. But basically, a lot of these aspects, I appreciate hearing them from this panel as well, is kind of in our roadmap.
And would it be possible to have a super post-coronal views in our endoscopic
principle? This is the concept of artificial RR technologies. So the problem a bit, and this we might just check on first simulations, as the optic is very much in distorted image or squeezed image. Does the anatomy of a coronal image still look somehow you would recognize it? So if you match it on this fisheye optic of an endoscope, this is a question. But this can be quite easily simulated, let's say, and then we can judge that.
Any burning?
Not any burning idea,
comments.
But one problem.
Okay,
we should solve this. If you go to court, you will be asked whether you use navigation system or not. And if you ask for the navigation system to be reimbursed, the private, I mean insurance companies, do not pay.
No.
So we should prepare a guideline, which one should be. I mean, there is one, but it should be more refined. Which one can be paid, which one not?
I think that's not an issue. Even the American Academy and the Australian Academy, they do recommendations. There is no must or mandatory topic on each, though you can choose to use them. But I don't think that any judge will find you culprit of not having used the navigation system if you have provided standard of care in your surgery. Are there in Germany?
The publication last year from Ramakrishnan, he exactly showed this. And if you're not using navigation and you have a problem, you're not litigated by not using navigation. Right. So that's very important. Otherwise, everybody has to use navigation.
However, I think there are cases in the States where it has been raised. So I was at a panel in America discussing the same topic, and surgeons admitted that they turned on the navigation system. They never used it so that they could record in the notes it was with navigation in case of litigation. So I think we need to be very careful about wording any recommendation so that they are recommendations and not must use.
Well, that's exactly the reason why I think, at least I, until now, decided not to have European, also because Europe is very different. So it's already very different for all the different countries to have a one-size-fits-all solution. But also because even if it's a guideline, a recommendation, or something else which is not legally binding, it will still probably be held against people. And I still think even... What would happen if navigation is off, which happens quite often, and you make a mistake in that way? Would then the navigation be wrong? No. It's always the surgeon who's responsible and never the navigation.
Yes.
With or without. I think that's a very good summary of this whole discussion. We love navigation. We wouldn't like to live without it. We need navigation that is cheaper. I hope you heard that. and that will also help to penetrate. We have to try to, like with a lot of other things we discussed today, to convince the health payers that it's worth it. And that's not so easy. But something we as ENT surgeons have to work on to explain that to the payers that it's worth it. And we have still a lot to wish, and we hope you are going to help us to bring our wishes to the OR. Thank you very much for your contribution in this session.
Thank you.